Leon. Try that again. Good morning.
Good morning.
It's good to see you and welcome to the shouters on the front row. That's very impressive, especially after last week's wimpy effort. So to have some enthusiasm on the good morning is appreciated. Hope you're in good voice. Let's stand, let's worship the Lord together, and we're going to sing Great is Thy Faithfulness. We're going to miss out verse 2, and then we're going to go into a faithful one afterwards. So you guys, come and join them, folks. Let's stand together. Let's sing Faithful One, So Unchanging, Ageless One, You Are My Rock of Peace. That's good. Let's sing it one more time.
Thank you.
Please be seated. The world has an expression, doesn't it, on the rocks, and it literally means things are falling apart. And at times, I don't know about you, we look at life and think everything's going haywire, it's all out of sync. And Shakespeare said, troubles don't come as single spies, but as whole battalions. And they all come at the same time, not one problem, but half a dozen. You think, I can't handle this. And life seems on the rocks. But for us as believers, we build on the rock, don't we? We have a foundation. So maybe know his strength in those unwavering and difficult times. Let's pray, shall we? Lord, our theology tells us that you are a faithful God. But thank you that we can look back and our experience tells us that as well. When we have failed you, when we have wandered, when we have let you down, when we have openly rebelled against you, Lord, thank you that in your faithfulness, in your goodness, in your mercy, you didn't write us off, but you were patient and you waited and you welcomed us back, Lord, when we came. Thank you, Lord, that we can build our life on you, a solid foundation. Lord, may we know that to be true in this present times in which we live. Lord, great is your faithfulness. You are unlike us. You're consistent and you are good. So help us, Lord, to enjoy that goodness. And thank you, Lord, that you're not like a shadow that's always changing its size. But Lord, you are consistent. And Lord, we pray that we might know your comfort and help day by day. Thank you that your compassions, they fail not. Just like every morning the sun shines, it's new and fresh. So your mercy, your love, your goodness, your faithfulness towards us is fresh and new. Thank you, Lord, for the hope we have, pardon for sin and a peace that endureth. Lord, if we're feeling that we're in the midst of a storm at this very moment, help us to sense your peace this morning, we pray. Bring a calm. Lord, thine, O dear presence, to cheer and to guide. Lord, lift our spirits. When we look around, we get distressed. We see the misery of humanity. We see the ongoing conflicts of war and famine and disease and man's greed and selfishness. And they're evident all around us, internationally and locally. Lord, help us to find a bright hope for tomorrow by focusing on you. And the way that you are at work in our lives, in the lives of this church, and in other people. Lord, thank you that blessings are ours, 10,000 beside. Lord, for health, for strength, for food, for clothing, for our families, for the nation in which we live, which is at peace and provides us so many comforts for life. We say thank you. Thank you, Lord, for this building, that we're in a building that is pleasant, that it's heated. Thank you that we have the Word of God, not just one Bible, but we have our own individual Bibles. We have it in our own language. Lord, you have blessed us abundantly. Thank you for the liberty and the freedom this morning to be able to publicly sing and declare your Word without fear of arrest or persecution. Lord, you have blessed us so much. We think of a persecuted church around the world. People in North Korea this morning, even unable to sing hymns verbally, lest they're heard and reported and arrested. So, Lord, thank you for the blessings that we take for granted. And we think of all our spiritual blessings in Christ, which are so much more valuable and lasting than these earthly ones. So, Lord, we come to you, we bring you our praise and our thanksgiving, and we commit our time to you now in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. So good to see you folks. Good to see anyone who's online joining us or on catch up later. And I suppose the big announcement is don't rush home if you're a member of the church, because after our cup of tea, we're going to have a bit of lunch together. And then we've got our members meeting at 1 o'clock just to bring you up to date with one or two things that are happening. So that is good. Right, we've got a Bible reading. We're looking at Acts, and one or two sent me references saying you've copied and pasted next week's reference the same as this week's. It's not a mistake, it's deliberate. Okay, so this morning is a bit of like a springboard, and then next week we'll unpack it a little bit more. So these verses are great verses, I think there was a time in this sort of church where they were read almost every other week at our breaking of bread type services. So important to church life. So Acts 2, 41 to 47. Next week you get 41 knocked off, okay? So it's a bit of a discount. We're going to start at verse 42. But this is what it says. Let's read it alternatively. Those who accepted his message. This is the day of Pentecost. The Apostle Peter is preaching the very first sermon as a Christian. The Holy Spirit has come with great boldness. He runs out into a public gathering and he starts to preach. And I'm not sure he ever preached a better sermon. So it's his first and his best sermon. Those who accepted his message. When Peter preached, he got a response. Someone said, when I preach, people need a cup of tea or coffee at the end of the service to wake them up. When Peter preached, he called people to faith. And as a result, they got baptized. If you go to the temple in Jerusalem, even to this day, outside are hundreds of little kind of baths, little mini baptistries for ceremonial washing before you went into the temple. And that's no doubt what Peter used. He called people to faith and he said, there's water, let's baptize them. And as a church, as a principle, we've held that if someone asks for baptism, we see if they're a believer, and if they are, we baptize them. And we have two people on the fringe of the church, one of the girls in youth club, and one lady who's come now and again, who's not a regular here, have both asked for baptism on that principle. Can I get baptized? I believe in Jesus. And that's something we're thinking through as an eldership. So you can pray for that. Pray for wisdom as to how we move forward. But it's the next step. It comes with conversion. If you believe, you get baptized. They're not separate events. They should be one and the same. And about 3,000 were added to their number that day. That's an impressive sermon, isn't it? A work of God. Let's read verse 42. Your turn. Everyone was filled with awe at the many wonders and signs performed by the apostles.
All the believers were together and had everything in common.
Oh, my turn. Sounds a bit like communism, doesn't it? It's not communism. We'll explain next week why they did that and how it works out for us today. They sold property and possessions to give to anyone who had need. Praising God and enjoying the favor of all the people, and the Lord added to their number daily those who are being saved. And that's our prayer here, isn't it? That the Lord will add to our number. It'd be great if it was daily. I'll take weekly or even monthly. But wouldn't it be good if God adds to our number those who are being saved? So God bless his word. We're back at that time of the year again, folks. Abbi McCann, this is your moment. Give Abbi a round of applause. Welcome her up here. You've got a mic.
Hello, it's good to be here again. We're starting to think about Christmas already. It's only just the new year. I'm Abigail McCann, and I've been coordinating the church's collecting shoeboxes for Samaritan's Purse for Operation Christmas Child. And last year, we made, as a church, we sent out 145 boxes. We don't know yet where they've been to, but once I find out, I'll let you know where they went to bless children there. So, this year, how many boxes are we going to manage? Can we make 150? Will we make more? So that's our aim. We're going to do it a little bit differently this year. So instead of having a monthly focus like we had last year, we're going to have a focus for 2 months before we change to another focus to give a bit more time to get the different items. And for those that might be making items, it gives a bit more chance to be able to make them. So some of the focuses will be combined. So last year we had some months that had like similar things to the previous month. So they'll be combined and just have a focus for 2 months before we move to something different. So for January and February, same as last year, can we collect clothing, hats, scarves, gloves, mittens for the children ages 2 to 14, and that they need to be in good condition, but they can be handmade if you're able to make them, or they can be bought. And we'll have the green box in the foyer again to put your collecting items in. So let's see how many we get. I'll give you an update next month of how we're doing. So thank you.
Thank you, Abbi. Right, kids, I need your participation. And I'm going to put some pictures on the board, and there is a connection. So here's the first picture. Well, that's my intro slide, actually. See if you can engage your brain and find the connection. So here's the connection. I've got a dog and a tree. So this is for the under-12s, really. If you think you know what the connection might be, a dog and a tree, they've got something in common. Anybody look at the pictures and think they can guess? Joe? You got it. The key word is bark. So dogs bark, and trees have bark on the outside. We've just written an article for Counties, and we really confused the editor because I said the doorbell when I go to Moldova isn't bing bong, it's a dog in the yard that barks. Every house has a yappy little dog that is as vicious as can be, and that is the security system and the doorbell out there in Moldova. So dogs bark and trees bark. Now this is going to be easy because you know the connection now. How about this one? There's an eye and a boy on the picture, but what's the connection? Does anybody know? An eye and a boy. Luke, you got it, pupil. So the eye has a pupil, and if you attend a school, you are called a pupil. A pupil is another name for student. Okay, well done. 2 out of 2. I'm very impressed. How about this one? Hula hoops and someone's hand with an item on it. What's the connection? Hula hoops and a piece of jewellery. Right at the back, Grace. You got it, ring. A ring is something that is circular, but a ring, of course, is also an item of jewellery. So we've got one word that has 2 different meanings. Brilliant, 3 out of 3. Wonder if I'll get you on this one. Oh, a bit of a burnt bread that you might have had for breakfast, and some people on the champers, having a glass of champagne, and the sun's going straight up here. I'm looking for someone I haven't had before. Keegan. Oh, a bit loud, I can't hear. No, good try. They don't represent the words of the Bible and Jesus. Good try. It could have been bread and wine, communion. I think that's what you're thinking of. But I've got something that you would eat at breakfast time and something you might consume at a special occasion. And it's given a name. I'm going to go Rebecca. Toast. Toast. So bread that's been in the toaster or under the grill is something you eat. But at a wedding, you have a glass of champagne or orange juice or water and you have a toast, a drink, and a little kind of a cheers to the bride and the groom, and you have a toast. So that word toast can have 2 meanings. Oh, a building and a group of people. A building and a group of people. Church, of course. We call buildings church, but as I reminded you last week, in the Bible, the New Testament, never is a building ever referred to as a church. Only a group of people are called churches in the New Testament. It's the Greek word ecclesia. It means you're called out and called together. And I'll let you into a secret. It's a word Christians stole. Because before Christians used the word church, it was a word that people used for any group of people. If you were a group of scouts, you were a church of scouts. You separated yourselves for scouting purposes. If you played football, you were a church of footballers because you separated yourself to focus on football. So whatever group you were, technically you were a church. And Christians got hold of the word and it kind of became exclusive to them. When they met together to talk about Jesus, they became the Church of Jesus Christ. So the word has 2 meanings. Now, for you adults, or maybe you kids, you'll educate them. Anybody know the posh word for when one word has 2 meanings? It begins with H. Anyone know the posh word, Abbi? Hominin. Well done. Give that girl a pat on the back. They are called hominins. You see, Mr. Fielder, it's an education coming here, isn't it? An education. So, when we think of church upstairs or downstairs today, we can think of building, but actually think of people. If you're a Christian, you're part of the church. Okay. Now, keeping with words, I thought we'd sing a song, and we haven't had this for donkey's years here. I am a C. I am a C-H. I am a C-H-R-I-S-T-I-A-N. Who can tell me what word that spells? Anyone help me out? Boaz. Christian. And I have C-H-R-I-S-T, which is, who can tell me? Keegan. Christ in my H-E-A-R-T. Can anyone tell me what? Heart. And here's the hard one. It's two words squashed together. And I shall L-I-V-E-E-T-E-R-N-A-L-L-Y. Oh, Grace at the back. Live eternally. Well done. And the secret to singing that is the E-E. You have to imagine your little mouth. E-E. If you pause and say E-E, you'll be left behind. So you've got to go E-E really, really fast, okay? And we'll sing it slow and it gets a little bit faster each time. So join in if you've got it.
I am a C. I am a C-H-R-I-S-T-I-A-N. And I have C-H-R-I-S-T. And I will L-I-V-E-E. And again. I am a C. I am a C-H. I am a C-H-R-I-S-T-I-A-N. And I have C-H-R-I-S-T in my H-E-A-R-T. L-I-V-E-E-T.
Not bad, a bit faster.
I am a C. I am a C-H. I am a C-H-R-I-S-T-I-A-N. And I have C-H-R-I-S-T in my H-E-A-R-T.
And a bit faster. Last time.
I am a C. I am a C. I am a C. And I am a C.
I think we'll leave it there. It goes on and on. It's left me exhausted. I don't know about you. Hey, words. But Christian really has one meaning, not two. A Christian is someone who is Christ-like, a follower of Christ, someone who has him in their heart. In other words, they put Christ first. They have a love for Christ and a desire to follow Christ. And may that be our experience today. Okay, we're going to sing again. We tried this last week and nobody knew it. So we've had one practice last week. We can sing it again. God of grace, amazing wonder, irresistible and free. Lovely words. And then we'll sing a couple of others afterwards. Come thou fount of every blessing, and I love you, Lord. But we'll start with this one, God of grace. Shall we stand to sing?
Thank you.
Let's sing it as a follow-on. Come, O Fount of every blessing, tune my heart to sing your grace. Grace is when God gives us what we don't deserve. And he's given us forgiveness. He's given us his Holy Spirit. He's given us the hope of heaven. Not because we deserved it, but because he likes us. He loves us. Just sing one more in response to his love for us. Let's declare our love for him. I love you, Lord, and I lift my voice to worship you. Thank you. Please be seated. Explorers, you're going upstairs to explore, and we're staying downstairs to explore. Good, let's pray for the little ones and for ourselves. Lord, thank you that we can declare that we love you. We're not ashamed, we're not embarrassed to say that. You're the God who first loved us, and you gave yourself for us. And in response to that magnificent act, we thank you that you have spiritually opened our eyes so that we can see, made us aware of that love, that mercy, that grace you have lavished upon us. And in return, Lord, we can declare our love for you. Thank you that you have not abandoned us, but you have given us the Holy Spirit, you've given us each other, and you've promised, Lord, never to leave us or forsake us. You've given us your word to feed us. And we pray, Lord, this morning as we open it up, feed our souls, Lord, afresh, we pray. Bless your word to us and to the little ones. Be with Kathy as she seeks to bring truths home to them too. For we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, this is week two in a look at a kind of a mini-series of four on the church. And this morning we're going to look at the church, or the wife every church should marry. The wife every church should marry. We'll get there. And that'll give us a springboard then for next week when we're looking at Christian fellowship. What do we mean when we talk about fellowship? And then the week afterwards, what do we mean when we talk about every member ministry and spiritual gifts? How do we get involved practically in our local church? So last week we set the foundation. This week we're looking at the wife every church should marry. Next week, fellowship. And the week after that, our involvement and our gifting in the local church. Acts chapter 2. Verse 41 to 47. A military commander had a sign on his desk. And this is what the sign said. The secrecy of my job does not permit me to know what I am doing. The secrecy of my job does not permit me to know what I'm doing. Now, of course, that might be tongue in cheek. It is important to know what we are doing and where we are heading in life generally, but especially as a local church, the body of Christ. In Alice in Wonderland, the book by Lewis Carroll, there is an interesting little snippet, episode, or dialogue between Alice and the cat. And Alice is unsure which way she should be going. So she says to the cat, she asks this question. Would you tell me, please, which way I ought to go from here? Well, the unhelpful cat replies, that depends a good deal on where you want to get to. Alice responds, I don't much care where. And the cat says, then it doesn't matter which way you go. And as an added afterthought, Alice responds, so as long as I get somewhere. And the cat says, oh, you're sure to do that if only you walk long enough. Now, of course, as a church, we're not meant just to be going somewhere. We should have a focus, a plan, a direction, so that we are moving closer to our destination. But that requires thinking, re-evaluating, rethinking in those cases, individually, but also collectively. And when we rethink, when we re-evaluate the why and the what of what we do, it should help focus us and clarify for us what we do and where we're going. But that can sometimes be difficult and painful. And as elders of this church, over the years, we've set a day apart every year just as a retreat day. And I can remember Alistair with his board and his pens writing on it, all the things we do in the church. And we pray through and talk through, what are we doing? How can we do them better? Do we still need to do them? And we tick them off one by one. And hopefully we made changes that have improved in those areas, so that we know where we're going and what we're doing. And it's a regular thing that we have to do, individually, but also collectively as church leaders. Now here in Acts chapter 2, we have the church in embryonic form. This is the first and the only church on planet Earth at this time in history. The church has just been born. The cradle is still rocking. And this is what the original looks like. Just before we came in, me and Scotty were talking about songs. I went out into the foyer and sang a song, and he actually knew what it was from my tuneless rendition. And then he told me who the original artist was. And very seldom does a cover version match the original. For example, the Pet Shop Boys sang Always On My Mind. Now, was that as good as Brenda Lee or Elvis Presley? No way. But that's my humble opinion. Take that, did a cover of Barry Manilow's Could It Be Magic? Well, it was more successful financially, but was it better? You decide. The Gypsy Kings sang Hotel California. Was that better than the Eagles? Jimi Hendrix covered Bob Dylan's All Along the Watchtower. Was it a better version? Well, it certainly comes close as he electrified an acoustic song. Is the cover version better than the original? What a cover version does is this. It brings it back to people's attention to a new generation and it gives it life. And when you reinterpret something, you're bringing it to people's attention and you're giving it life again. And you can decide. And I think age says, no, the old one was better rather than the new. But I think there's a spiritual parallel there that you can think about. Now, this is the original, the only church on planet Earth at this moment in time in history. So it tells us what the very first church looked like. And when you analyze it, you can determine two things. First, we'll be able to see the model we're expected to follow as a church. And then secondly, we'll be able to see why we need the church. Just from looking at this original church, the model we're expected to follow and why we need the church. Now, some of you might think, well, aren't you looking through the early church through rose-colored or rose-petaled or rose-tinted glasses? I think that's the right expression. You're just looking at the pleasant things. Well, in one sense, yes. But I'm a realist. Walter Ewell, in his book, says, in the New Testament alone, when other churches came along that we read about in the New Testament, 150 faults had to be corrected in the book of Acts and the letters to those early churches. Now, that tells me there's no such thing as a perfect church or a church that doesn't make mistakes. 150 corrections in the New Testament to the churches that were developing around Asia and then into Europe. So no local church has ever been perfect. But in my opinion, here in Acts chapter 2, it's as good as it gets because this is the original. And before we look at the title, The Wife Every Church Should Marry, I want to just spend a bit of time, and it's a bit of a long opening, I appreciate, on some statements from Warren Wiersbe. In his book, Making Sense of the Ministry, he gives 10 pieces of advice. And I think actually they work into our situation. So we're going to labor those for a little bit before we go on to the wife every church should marry. So it may seem a little long, 10 points by introduction. It's better than I remember Ivor Cooper standing up and saying, and finally, just 10 points to finish with. So at least you've got them at the beginning of the sermon rather than at the end of the sermon. First of all, what do we mean by the term ministry? Well, another word for ministry is service. That's what we do as a church. As a church, we have a ministry, a service, and every individual member has a ministry and a service. We work and we serve in the name of God to the blessing of others. That's why we function as a church. In the name of God, we want to bless and serve others. So the church is not a club you join. It is a family you belong to. And in all families, there are pros and cons, privileges and responsibilities. And young people find that if they want to eat, they've got to wash up at some stage in the week. It's part of the calling, isn't it, of being in a family. It's not just left to one person. There are responsibilities in the household as well as privileges. And being part of a church fellowship, I would suggest, should be active, not passive. As the saying goes, you don't go to church because you are the church. And when we come together, we can be active, not just passive. And Warren Wiersbe's title, or 10 statements in his book, keeping my ministry on target, keeping my service on target, keeping my role in the local church on target, will apply to all of us. So I give you these principles as a long introduction, but I think they hit the nail on the head. His first statement is this: the foundation of ministry, of service, of my part in the local church is character. Now, foundation is the most important to any building. And I was telling the kids on Friday, I went and stood on the baptistry and stood on it, and you have that hollow sound, you're safe, don't panic. And then next to it, I stood and kicked the floor, and it was solid. And I was just saying, look, what we've got under here is like a mini swimming pool. This is solid, this isn't. But even under the foundation of the baptistry, there is a foundation. The building is built to last. And last week we sang the kids' song about the wise and the foolish builders. We know the importance of a foundation. If you build on sand, your house collapses. If you build on the rock, it remains secure. Sure, when the storms come, you might lose the fence. A few tiles on the chimneys might fall off. The windows may rattle. But it stands firm. It stands firm. And character is like the foundations of a house. It is unseen but essential. You know, I don't think anyone's ever walked in this church in the 100 years it's existed and said, great foundations you've got here. No, they might comment about the old curtain we used to have at the front. Cool, when are you getting rid of that? They might comment about the colour of the seats. They might comment about, you've got a lot of light coming through the windows. They might comment about the big text or the colour of the walls. 101 things, but no one's ever come through the doors and said, good foundations you've got. Unseen but essential. And in our ministry, in our service, in our part in the church, character is key. Jim Peterson said this, the existence of a unique people whose lives are marked by God himself has always been fundamental to his program of reconciling the world to himself. His people incarnate his character. They audio-visualize the nature of his eternal reign. So if your character is poor, work on it. So principle number one, or statement number one, the foundation of ministry, service, your part in the church is character. Point number two, the nature of ministry, service, your part is service. As I mentioned a few minutes ago, the word minister and service come from the same root work. And all Christians are called to serve. Now, Alistair Begg, is one of Martin's favourite speakers. You can watch him online, you can listen to his sermons, you can buy his books. But Alistair Begg says this, it is not that some are called to Christ and then go on to service, but it is that to be called by Christ is to be called to service. So we don't invite some to be the servants and others to be the served, but all of us are called to be the servants. And if you do a simple Google search of the word servant or service in the New Testament, verse after verse jump out at you. For example, 1 Peter 4:10, each of you should use whatever gifts you have received. Why? To serve others. To serve others. And we've been brought together here today as the body of Christ so that collectively we can build each other up. Last night, this place was full of kids and young leaders for bodybuilders. Every seat was taken. It was brilliant. Brilliant time. And we call it bodybuilders, not because we're pumping iron, but when the church meets together who are the body of Christ, we build one another up spiritually by our fellowship, by our prayer, by our study of the word. Hence the name bodybuilders. And the nature of our ministry is to encourage and build each other up. So the Christian life is not about receiving as such, it's about giving. It's not about taking, it's releasing. It's not about being served, it's serving others. Here's his third statement. The motive for ministry, for service, for my part in the church, is love. Jesus was asked a question on one occasion by a Pharisee. He said, which is the greatest commandment? We've got the whole Torah, and we've got special 10 commandments and many commandments that are linked to them. Well, which is number one? Which is most important? And in Matthew 12, 28, Jesus said, the most important one is this. Hear, O Israel, the Lord your Lord is one. Love him with all your heart, soul, and with all your mind and strength. And the second is to love your neighbor as yourself. In other words, he said, you love God and you love others. He summarized all the commandments in two statements, love for God and love for others. That's the whole point of the law in the Old Testament. That's the principle of the New Testament. Our motivation for ministry or service is never so that I get a pat on the back and everyone thinks I'm wonderful or I've just done my part. We do it for love for the Lord and we do it for love for other people. That's why we serve. Statement number four, the measure of ministry is sacrifice. You know the old story of the pig and the hen who are walking down the road. And as they're walking down the road, they see a cafe, and in the window is a sign. And on the sign, it says, bacon and eggs for breakfast. So the pig turns to the hen and said, well, it's all right for you. For you, it's an offering. But for me, it's a sacrifice. Ministry or service always costs. Whatever we do will cost in time. It will cost in energy and effort. It's never easy. The measure of ministry, service, my part in the church, requires sacrifice. Statement number five. The authority of ministry, service, my part in the church, is submission. Now, there's a word we don't like. I'm told Gladiators is back on the telly. And I only ever watched 5 minutes of it. It was just not for me. But it's one guy trying to catch another guy over an assault course, if my memory serves me well. And what they do is, I think they knock them off the course and they win. When I was a kid, my highlight on the telly wasn't Gladiators. It was Saturday afternoon wrestling on TV. Do you remember that? Jackie TV Palo. Les somebody with a funny hair. All these wrestlers. And in wrestling, you got your opponent. You knocked them on the floor. Giant haystacks. You remember giant haystacks? A big daddy. You got your opponent on the floor and you held them there until they said, I submit. It was three falls or a submission. As soon as they said, I submit, you had won. And in our minds, submission is always negative. Negative. But in the Bible, it's not. In the Bible, it is a positive trait, a positive characteristic and attitude. Ministry cannot work without submission. We would use the word compliance, agreement, rather than submission. In other words, we don't rule over people, we serve people. I suppose if you want to paraphrase it, submission is thinking what's best for the other person rather than what's best for me. And the Apostle Paul in Philippians chapter 2, in the first five verses, talks about submitting to one another. And then he gives that illustration of Jesus, one of the great creeds or hymns of the early church, who being in the very form God, did not consider equality with God something to be grasped on, but instead made himself a servant, humbling himself, coming into the world and even dying on a cross. And we often quote that part of the passage and we forget the first five verses that are teaching submission, and that's just an illustration of how we do it. R.T. Kendall is one of my favourite authors and speakers. I know he's a little bit wacky here and there over the last few years, but overall he's good, meaty stuff. And R.T. Kendall, when he commentates on Philippians chapter 2, verses 1 to 5, says, most problems in any church could be solved if we put these verses into practice. Statement number six, according to Warren Wiersbe, the purpose of ministry, of service, or my part in the church, is to glorify God. That is, of course, always the reason for whatever we do. Our ultimate purpose is to bring God glory. Some of you may have grown up on catechisms like the Westminster Catechism. It's a series of questions and answers that teach people their faith. And in the shorter Westminster Catechism, the very first question says this: what is the chief end of man? Hey, what is the purpose of human beings? Why are we here on planet Earth? What is the chief end of man? And the answer is this: man's chief end is to glorify God and enjoy him forever. I love that, to enjoy God, not to just, you know, be a robot. We glorify God and we enjoy God. Well, that phrase isn't actually in the Bible, but the principle is. What we're created to do, to know God, to love God, and to serve him. How do we do that? When we voluntarily and joyfully serve him. Statement number seven, the tools of ministry, service, my part in the church, are prayer and the word of God. The tools of ministry are prayer and the word of God. You remember that incident in Acts chapter 6 when the apostles are being sidetracked by the practical problems that are in the church. And they said, look, we haven't got time to lead the church and to sort out the widows and to do this and that. So what do? We will devote ourselves to prayer and the ministry of the word. And they appointed deacons to do the practical stuff, to free them up. They prioritized. We've got limited time, so what are we going to focus on? We can focus on this because other people could do that, but not everyone can do that. So it's a case of division of time and energy and resources. And that statement summarizes the job description of church leaders: prayer and the ministry of the word. But it should be true for all service, shouldn't it? Whatever we do, we need to pray it through. And we want to do, or we want to share God's word in the situations we find ourselves in. Statement number 8: the privilege of ministry, service, my part in the church, is growth. Growing deeper, growing closer, growing larger. Don't miss that. Growing deeper, growing closer, growing larger. Most of us, when we hear the word church growth, think numbers. Is my church growing? They're growing down the road. Why aren't we growing here? One of the problems of growing numerically is you don't grow deeper and closer because you've always got new people you're meeting. It's hard to develop those closer relationships. But growing deeper, am I growing up in my faith? Am I maturing or just growing old? Too many grey-haired babies in too many churches where people have been there for years, but they're still spiritual babies because they've grown up physically old, but they haven't grown up spiritually and matured. Am I growing up deeper? Growing closer. Are our relationships deeper? I have to confess that maybe since COVID, my relationships with a lot of people have taken a step backwards instead of forwards. I spend less time, I know less about them now than I did before COVID, just because of other demands in my life. That's to my shame and something I have to put right. Can I grow deeper in my relationships with the folks in the fellowship? And can we grow larger? Am I doing my bit to help the church grow evangelistically? Statement number 9. The power of ministry, of service, of my part in the church is the Holy Spirit. A.W. Tozer said some words years ago. If the Lord removed the Holy Spirit from this world, much of what we are doing in the church would continue and nobody would not even know the difference. How shocking that statement is, and yet how true. If God took his Holy Spirit from Duncan Road Church, would we carry on as per normal and no one would even notice? Reminds me of the story of a little boy who came home from church and he knelt down by his bed at night and he started to say his prayers. He said, Lord, he said, oh, it was fantastic tonight. Oh, what a service. He said, the songs were spot on. The music was uplifting. The preacher was sure. Lord, it was brilliant. If only you'd have been there, you'd have enjoyed it. Well, we know theologically the Lord is always present where two or three are gathered. But how often we come and we leave and we haven't sensed his presence. We haven't heard from his word. We've left as cold as we arrived. That's not necessarily the musician's or the preacher's fault. Is it our fault for the way we turned up in the first place? But we need a filling of the Holy Spirit, don't we? You remember that classic verse? You don't hear it quoted often these days. Zechariah 4 verse 6. Not by might, not by power, by my Spirit. The Living Bible says, you will succeed because of my Spirit. And there are no shortcuts in ministry or the Christian life. We are only ever channels. Channels only, blessed Savior. And Christian life and Christian ministry is not God and us. It is not us and God. It is always God through us. Not God and us, not us and God, God through us. And then his last statement, the model for ministry, for service, for my part in the local church, is Jesus Christ. You know, on a Sunday afternoon, I quite often drive up to the motorway and go up to Speaker's Corner. I park outside the Albert Hall along that road there. If you ever go up on a Sunday afternoon, don't take my space. Okay, so I park along there, and about 1,500 yards along from the Albert Hall is the statue of David Livingstone. And it breaks my heart when people just walk. They've all got their cameras to take pictures of all the stuff in London, and they walk by it and no one ever gives it a second look. And I feel like saying, stop, it's David Livingstone, come and take his picture. And if you don't know who he was, shame on you, shame on you. One, he was an incredible explorer. Bear Grylls is an amateur compared to David Livingstone. Bear Grylls wouldn't tie up his shoelaces. David Livingstone's the real deal. Secondly, he was against the Arab slave trade that flooded Africa's east coast. He called it a trade in hell that was an open sore to the wound, and he did as much as a human being could do to abolish slavery in that part of the world. And then thirdly, he was a committed Christian missionary. Where he went, he shared the gospel, gave his life for Christ. Incredible man, Livingstone. And he once said this about Jesus: he is the greatest master I have known. If there is anyone greater, I do not know him. Jesus Christ is the only master supremely worth serving. He is the only ideal that never loses its inspiration. He is the only friend whose friendship meets every demand. He is the only savior who can save to the uttermost. We go forth in his name, in his power, and in his spirit we serve. And if you want an example, a model, look at Jesus. And he said, this church is mine. I will build my church. I'm the architect. I have the design plans for the church universal and the church local. And never forget, Christ loved the church and he gave himself for it, the Bible says. That's the value he puts on every local congregation. Now, with all that in mind, please don't give up on me. Let's very briefly look at the wife. That the church should marry. Four quick pictures. We're not going to delve into them in great detail. And verse three, or the third one, I'm going to skip over because we're looking at it next week. Wife is an acrostic. W-I-F-E. For each of those four letters, there's a key word. I haven't made up that title. Charles Swindoll does it in one of his books. The wife every church should marry. W stands for worship. Verse 42. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching, and to the fellowship, to the breaking of bread, and to prayer. What do we see in that verse? We see committed, worshipful people. Don't miss that little word, devoted. Devoted. It signifies a steadfast, single-minded commitment. They weren't half-hearted. And did you see the simplicity of their worship? They broke bread and they prayed. That's all we're told. That's how they worshipped. They broke bread and they prayed. I wonder how we'd get on if I said for the next 2 months, all we're going to do on a Sunday morning is break bread and pray. But our numbers go up or down. It reminds me of what Spurgeon said about the prayer meeting. The prayer meeting where the only attraction is God. Well, the early church experienced God's presence in a special way. Look at verse 43. Everyone was filled with awe. And there came to every soul fear. That's what it literally says. Wouldn't it be fantastic if we were filled with awe every time we met together? We left this place on a spiritual high because we knew the presence of God. And I just love verse 46. With glad and sincere heart. Glad, they were happy to be there. And notice, they met every day. Every day. Sincere. In other words, their worship was pure. They came focused to enjoy the Lord. Worship dominated the early church. Now, we can worship God in many ways and in many varieties, but it has to be there. Secondly, I, instruction, verse 42. Not only was they a worshipping congregation, they were a learning congregation. they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching. We would say our New Testament, that's the apostles' teaching put into print. Before it was put into print, it was verbally taught. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching. Did you notice that's first on the list? Is that most important? Well, in many ways, yes. Because without food, you die. We've got two babies in the church. If they're not getting their milk every 4 hours, they will die. And if they're not being fed, they will let their parents know they want their food. And whether you're a baby who needs milk or you're an adult who wants steak, we need feeding, else we die. And if we're not fed, we become spiritually weak and ill. That's why he puts teaching first. Thirdly, F, fellowship. And we're going to develop this next week. The church is a worshipful people. The church is a learning congregation. The church is a caring flock. It's not a place you come, learn, and then leave. It's a place we should care for one another. And when I talk about the church, I don't mean four walls. The church is the body. So if we visit someone in their home, we're caring for them in the church. So church is bigger than four walls. Please remember that. We'll develop fellowship next week. Someone has said, look, teaching is what feeds people, but it's fellowship that keeps people. People want to know they're loved and part of a family. And if we don't feel loved and part of a family, we just go somewhere else, because we get teaching in any church, really. Might not be as good, but if they love me down the road and they teach me, I'll go there rather than come here, where the teaching might be better, but no one loves me. I'm not saying that's true. I'm just saying that's the principle, isn't it? We all want to be accepted and valued. And then fourthly, evangelism. You don't see that, do you? See, the church is an outreaching body. And you'll see that all the way through the book of Acts. But there's something we've forgotten or reversed in Acts chapter 2. The church that's gathering is worshipful, it's prayerful, it's teachable, and then it scatters to evangelize. They didn't invite people to the church to come to faith. They went and shared their faith with the people. They scattered to evangelize. Michael Green, in his book, Evangelism in the Early Church, said this: Christianity was supremely a lay movement. That term means not the pastor or the vicar. It was about the congregation. Christianity was supremely a lay movement spread by informal missionaries. The spontaneous outreach to the total Christian community gave immense impetus to the movement from the very start. In other words, people did evangelism wherever they went. And folks came to faith, and then they brought them to the church to be taught and fed and to worship God. And we see that at the beginning of Acts chapter 1, the church is 120 people, Acts 1:15. In Acts 2:41, before these verses, Peter preaches 3,000 come to faith. So the church is now 3,120 big. And if you turn over to chapter 4, verse 4, many who heard the message believed, so the number of men who believed grew to about 5,000. But well, that's just the men. There were so many there, they didn't bother counting the women and kids. They just counted the men and said 5,000. So it could have been 8,000 or 9,000. And it just grows and grows and grows and spreads. So the secret, according to Michael Green, was everyone having been inspired by worship, fed by the word, filled by the Holy Spirit, went out and told their friends, their neighbors, their relatives about Jesus and helped win them to Christ. Let's pray. Lord, we've covered a lot of ground. Help us to ponder these things, to think them through, and apply that to our hearts, which is most appropriate. For we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Let's sing our last song, shall we? O church, arise and put your armour on. God has equipped us for his service and his work. O church, arise and put your armour on. Hear the call of Christ, our captain. Mm-hmm. Let's conclude with this little benediction, shall we? May the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Amen. Please be seated. Our service is over. Do stay for refreshments and enjoy the rest of your day.